Do you inherit debt in Canada? CRA says yes to property transfers. Introduction. When conversations of financial obligations happen, people usually joke around and state they'll finally be without debt upon their death. Many people who come to me for their no-cost consultation also ask, "Do you inherit debt in Canada?" A recent decision of the Tax Court of Canada inspired me to write this Brandon's blog to discuss the issue. What happens to debt when you die in Canada? In general, what happens to debt when you die in Canada is that your executor or executrix, in Ontario it is called an estate trustee, needs to understand all of the deceased's assets and liabilities. The estate trustee needs to make sure that all debts are paid off before making any distribution to the beneficiaries. Unless you have co-signed for or guaranteed someone else's loan, you are not responsible for your spouse's or parents' debts upon their death. There are generally two exceptions. The first is credit card debt, where usually a spouse has a supplementary credit card on the same account. In that case, you need to look at the credit card agreement because the supplementary cardholder might be responsible for the debt. So if there are insufficient assets in the estate to pay off the credit card debt, the supplementary cardholder may have to. Section 160 sub 1 of the Income Tax Act, Canada. Section 160 sub 1 of the Income Tax Act and its equivalent, Section 325 of the Excise Tax Act, can be utilized by the Canada Revenue Agency to assess tax obligation liability to those who received a transfer of property from persons with tax obligations at the time of the transfer. This indicates if a person offers you something of value, virtually anything, while they have a tax debt, the CRA can and will certainly pursue you. CRA's view is that the original tax obligation debtor ought to have sold whatever was transferred and the funds used to pay off the tax debt. This section of the Income Tax Act comes into play during the administration of a deceased estate or in an insolvency filing. The court decision, released on February 10, 2020, highlights this issue that death is no excuse when it comes to pay the tax man. The court case facts. The CRA assessed the two daughters of the deceased father $96,640.96 each under Section 160 sub 1 of the Income Tax Act in respect of a transfer of property from their father prior to his death. Each daughter has appealed the assessments to the Tax Court of Canada. The two appeals were heard together as the evidence and facts were identical. The agreed statement of facts was, 1. The father was the annuitant of a Franklin Templeton Investments Life Income Fund, and prior to his death, he designated each of his daughters as his irrevocable beneficiaries under the income fund. 2. In his last will and testament, he named his daughters as estate trustees and beneficiaries of his estate. 3. The father died on June 8, 2011. 4. On or about July 26, 2011, $96,640.96 was transferred to each of the daughters from the income fund. 5. Each of the daughters received the distribution on July 26, 2011. 6. The daughters provided no consideration in regard to the transfers. 7. On July 3, 2015, the Minister of Revenue assessed each of the daughters the $96,640.96 on the basis of subsection 160 sub 1 of the Income Tax Act. 8. The father had an outstanding tax liability of not less than the amount transferred with respect to his 2011 tax year. The tax liability regarding property transfer not at arm's length is set out in Section 160, Sub 1 of the Income Tax Act. When applying and identifying the applicability of Section 160, you need to also consider the interpretation of arm's length. The Federal Court of Appeal. The Federal Court of Appeal had already determined that the following four standards must be used when taking into consideration subsection 160 sub 1. 1. The transferor needs to be liable to pay tax at the time of the transfer. 2. There need to be a transfer of property, either straight or indirectly, through a trust or any other method. 3. The transferee must either be the transferor's spouse or common law relationship at the time of transfer, or a person who has since come to be the person's spouse or common law partner, a person who was under 18 years of age at the time of transfer, or an individual with whom the transferor was not dealing at arm's length. And 4, the fair market value of the property transferred needs to be greater than the true value of the consideration, if any, given by the transferee. The position of the parties. CRA's position was that this was a transfer of property from the father to the daughters prior to his death at a time when he had an outstanding income tax liability. The daughters stated that they accept that 3 of the 4 criteria set out by the Federal Court of Appeal have been satisfied. Particularly, the daughters agree that their father indirectly transferred the property to each of them, that he owed income tax relating to the tax year in which the transfer took place or a previous tax year, and that no consideration was paid by the daughters. Accordingly, both CRA and the daughters agreed that the only issue before the court to determine is whether the father and his daughters were dealing with each other at arm's length. The daughter's position was that at the time of the actual cash transfer, their father was dead. He did not exist, and for that reason, he was not a related individual within the meaning of the Income Tax Act, and therefore was not in blood relation with them at the time. CRA's position was simple. First, the time of the transfer was not when the investment firm paid the cash to the daughters. Rather, it was when the father designated them as irrevocable beneficiaries. Second, the father and his daughters were related not by contract, but by blood. So even death cannot take away that relationship. The court's decision. The court agreed totally with CRA's position, upheld the assessments against each of the daughters, and dismissed the appeals. They were found to have received the transfer of the property for no consideration at a time when the father owed income tax of a greater amount. The daughters were each liable to pay the amount of $96,640.96 to CRA. So in this case, if the daughters were asked, "Do you inherit debt in Canada?" they would have to answer a resounding yes. Insolvent and alive. I also come across this issue when providing a no-cost consultation to an insolvent person wanting to know their options. Whenever they disclose that they have an income tax debt, I ask about transfers between the person and his or her spouse or children. I do this to see if there are any Section 160 sub 1 transfer of property issues. If there are, an insolvency filing will merely highlight the transfer issue to CRA. When they get notice of the consumer proposal or the bankruptcy, they start their deep dive investigation into the affairs of the bankrupt. As a licensed insolvency trustee, I also have to advise the creditors of any issues like a transfer between related parties for no or little consideration. Once CRA determines a transfer took place between blood relations for little or no value being given or paid, they will assess the spouse or child under Section 160 sub 1 of the Income Tax Act. The outcome will be the same as in this court case. So alive or dead, transfers of property between blood relatives for little or no value is always troublesome. when it comes to income tax debt outstanding at the time, insolvency, death, and estate administration. I hope you enjoyed this Do You Inherit Debt in Canada, Brandon's blog, and that you have a better understanding that it is possible to inherit death in debt. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. Do you inherit debt in Canada?